Welcome to our Wednesday Bible discussion, Speaking Words of Life, Humility. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties, and see if there is any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Psalms chapter 139, verses 23-24.
Hey, people of God, how you guys doing today? We're here for our Wednesday Bible discussion, and we're talking about humility. The word that God has given us for today is simply humility. David asked God to search for the sin and pointed out, even to the level of testing his thoughts. This is exploratory surgery for sin. How are we to recognize sin unless God points it out? Then when God shows us, we can repent and be forgiven. Make your heart and your thoughts reveal your sin. You will be continuing on the path of everlasting life if you keep this in your heart and in your mind. What is it like to be on the other side of you? When I ask leaders where their biggest challenges or weaknesses are, they point to their teams. However, when the team is asked what they need to be better, they almost always cite the problem with the leadership. When I ask each group what the other's contributions are, the answers rarely match. This is a profound in conclusion between what most people believe it's like to be on the other side of them and what it is actually like to be on the other side of them. People of God, have you considered what it's like to be on the other side of you in your personal and professional life? Not what you want people to think, or the narrative that you created about yourself, but how people experience you in real time, people of God. Biomythography means a style of composition that weaves myths, histories, and biography in an epic narrative. It's basically the idea that you and I are consistently telling ourselves a story about ourselves and others, intertwined with some truth and with some myths. Amen. In our narratives, especially about other people we have tension with, we often tell ourselves stories where we're the heroes, amen, and that they're the villains. And in reality, neither is probably true. Amen.
Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? Matthew 7, verse 3.
Jesus is telling us to examine our own motives and conduct, and conduct instead of judging others. The traits that bother us is in others are often the habits we have ourselves. Did you hear what I said? The traits that bother us in others are often the habits we have ourselves. Our bad habits and behavior patterns are the very ones that we most want to change in others. Do you find it easy to magnify others' faults while excusing your own? If you are ready to criticize someone, check to see if you deserve the same criticism. Amen. Judge yourself first and then lovingly forgive and help your neighbor. You and I have the same superpower, people of God. We are really good at discerning what everybody else needs to work on. Our spouses, kids, leaders in the church, our in-laws, our colleagues, they all have a lot of work to do on themselves, right?
Our list for how everyone can improve is rather robust and long, but the list we have for ourselves is rather vague and short. I just don't think we pause long enough to consider what it is like to be on the other side of us. The minute we start talking about self-awareness, everyone assumes they have it and others don't, which is the irony of self-awareness. Self-awareness is the biggest problem we all have that none of us believe we have. But have you considered what it is like to be on the other side of you? Have you considered what the speck in your eye might be?
Do you know what it's like to be married to you? To date you? To work with you? To share a room with you? To travel with you? To be led by you? To raise children with you? Some of you might be thinking, it's awesome. But I would say, people of God, are you sure that's what people on the other side of you think? I think, and I should navigate the world with a sense that maybe we've got a speck in our eye, and that may be what it's like to be on the other side of us. This position isn't as enjoyable as we might think. It could be fun, it could be exhausting, but we will begin to grow when we live with the consideration of how others experience us. Amen.
Judge not that you be not judged, for with what judgment you judge, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck from your eye, and look, a plank is in your own eye? Hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 5.
Jesus' statement, do not judge others, is against the kind of hypocritical, judgmental attitude that tears others down in order to build oneself up. It is not a blanket statement to overlook wrong behavior of others, but a call to be discerning rather than negative. Jesus said to expose false prophets. And Paul taught that we should exercise church discipline and trust God to be the final judge. What mistakes can I own? Amen.
But he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. James chapter 4, verse 6.
The cure for evil desires is humility, people of God. Pride makes us self-centered and leads us to conclude that we deserve all we can see, all we can touch or imagine. It creates greedy appetites for far more than we need. We can be released from our self-centered desires by humbling ourselves before God, realizing that all we really need is His approval, people of God.
When the Holy Spirit fills us, we see that this world's seductive attractions are only cheap substitutes for what God has to offer.
Amen. One of the things that breaks my heart the most is the number of people I know who are no longer on speaking terms with their family, friends, and colleagues. Over one of these many hot topics: politics, health, world safety protocols, race, and what often happens in heated conversations is we all feel like we have to be right, people of God. And in the process of needing to be right, we often say things we regret. People of God, hindsight type is 2020. And looking back on some of those conversations that went south, I think what could have saved the conversation and potentially the relationship is a little bit of humility. You know, humility means the importance of knowing there's a chance, big or small, that you could be made, that you could have made an error. It's the ability to admit that we could be wrong. If we want our relationships to go to the next level, we have to enter conversations leaving room for somebody else's perspective. Come to the understanding that other perspectives may be correct, just coming from their viewpoint. Amen.
Humility is the antithesis of pride or arrogance. And in many references to this virtue within Scripture, it's both a state of being and an active pursuit. It takes practice to admit fault, resist pride, and do so habitually. Amen.
Humility is the antithesis of pride or arrogance. Jesus exhibited a posture of humility for us. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of man. And being found in the presence as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death. Even death on the cross, people of God. Philippians 2, 5, and 8. Amen.
Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8.
The incarnation was an act of pre-existing Son of God, voluntarily assuming a human body and human nature. Without ceasing to be God, he became a human being, the man called Jesus, people of God. He did not give up his deity to become human, but he set aside the right to his glory and his power. In submission to the Father's will, Christ limited his power and knowledge. Jesus of Nazareth was subject to place, time, and many other human limitations. What made his humanity unique was his freedom from sin. In his full humanity, Jesus showed us everything about God's character that can be conveyed in human terms. His humility was undeniable. Yet, this approach to leadership was precisely why the Jewish leaders denied his lordship. They were looking for someone of stature who carried themselves with a sort of arrogance like them and aligned with their views of positional power and prestige. People of God, humility has its perks. First, it models the way of Jesus. leading us to a sinful life. Second, our willingness to admit that we might not know expands our curiosity. It opens us up to new ideas. It builds trust in relationships and gives way to deeper learning.
Now it happened as they went that he entered a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she approached him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me." And Jesus answered and said to her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part which will not be taken away from her." Luke chapter 10, verses 38 through 42.
Well, God, let's learn to accept other differences, their perspective, different positions, and viewpoints on worship. Mary and Martha both loved Jesus. On this occasion, they were both serving him. But Martha thought Mary's style of serving was inferior to hers. She didn't realize that in her desire to serve, she was actually neglecting her guests. Are you so busy sometimes doing things for Jesus that you're not spending any time with him? Do you let your service become self-serving, people of God? Jesus did not blame Martha for being concerned about household chores. He was only asking her to set priorities. Service to Christ can be degenerated into mere busy work that is totally devoid of devotion to God.
But pride and arrogance, however, can cause us to have a false view of ourselves. Protecting our pride means we limit ourselves to new ideals, trusting others, being trustworthy, and reducing our transparency.
Humility is full of nuance and depth. It's being submissive, servant-hearted, modest, others-focused, and unassuming. For us, having humility enables us to admit we're wrong. Jesus was never wrong, but had humility. For some of us, rebuilding a bridge with a loved one could start with us admitting that we've missed the mark, we've dropped the ball, left no room for understanding, no room for compromise in the conversation. It was their way or the highway. People of God, the first four books of the Bible give us four different perspectives, descriptions, opinions, and viewpoints of the same events in Bible history. But they don't differ in the message. Amen. That's what's so bad about being wrong. Why do we have an exception, obsession with the being right? Excuse me, people. God, how many times in your life have you met someone looking for a mate that said, "The kind of person I want to be with is someone who's always right"? You haven't. Amen. For the sake of the relationships we have in our homes and in our careers, I believe we have to pause and wonder what it is we win for being right all the time. Be slow to take credit and quick to apologize. Amen. Praise God.
Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in an appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11.
The question I want you to think about today concerning this Bible discussion is that I believe it's good for our relationship with God and with others. Is what credit can I give away? What do I have to elevate somebody in the relationship I'm in with them? What do I have to give them credit for? What can I find to give them credit for? The question is I want to think about today is that the selfie industry is booming, people of God. Think about that. Self-care, self-help, self-work, self-aware, self-talk, self-love, amen, self-healing, self-defense, self-employment, self-improvement, self-leadership. But I think we have to be cautious with how many selfie conversations we have. By consistently being in selfie mode, we run the risk of becoming self-absorbed. Amen. What is even more dangerous is that we're being self-absorbed and actually believing we're self-made. This is a selfie that is often converted and even celebrated today.
It's easy to make our lives about selfies. It's easy to make our relationships about what is in it for us. When things are going well, we want all to take the credit. And when things are going bad, we all want to place the blame on others. But what's good for our soul is looking to God or someone else to praise and give credit to. Some people think they have something to lose by giving someone else credit. Maybe someone else will get promoted instead of them. But in all reality, what you lose when you give credit away is nothing. But what you gain when you give it away is trust and respect. How good does it feel when you are seen and valued and when your contribution is brought to the table?
How awesome does it feel to work for, work with, or be married to the person who gives credit away? We all love being around these people, but at some point, we have to decide to be that person. The Apostle Paul wrote a significant amount of the New Testament. To settle a dispute in the church at Corinth, young Christ followers were flaunting their affiliation with influential leaders. And Paul reduced the issue with this statement.
For we are all God's fellow workers. You are God's field or God's building. He who plants and he who waters are one, and each will receive his wages according to his labor. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth, the increase. What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believed as the Lord assigned to each.
People of God, at some point, we have to get to a place where we can think, I don't need to be that impressive. I don't need to be held, esteemed, or adored. It's not about me anyway. I surrender my life to Christ, who will take care of all the selfish areas of my life. It is better to work with, support, and build up the team or the people in my life who God uses for his purpose. Amen.
Who then is Paul and who is Apollos, but ministers through whom you believed as the Lord gave to each one? I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. Now he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 5 through 9.
God's work involved many different individuals with a variety of gifts and abilities. There are no superstars in this task. This is the master's plan. Only team members performing their own special roles. We can become useful members of God's team by setting aside our own desires to receive glory for what we do. Don't seek the praise that comes from people. It is comparatively worthless. Instead, seek approval from God, people of God. Philippians 2 and 3 says, don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others better than yourself. Amen.
Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Philippians chapter 2, verse 3.
We all love being on the receiving end of a person who acts like that, but we should aim to be on the giving end of that kind of lifestyle.
For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 9. And above all things, have fervent love for one another, for love will cover a multitude of sins. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8.
And above all things, have fervent love for one another. Father God, let the scriptures we discuss today fill our souls, stir up our spirits, and inspire the way we live. Amen. In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak. Remember the words of the Lord Jesus himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Whether it's grace or a piece of jewelry or a job title, we all have our ideas about what it means to be a successful Christian. Early on, the world teaches us that a certain car, a certain degree, and that stuck. If I ask you to picture someone successful, Raymond, what would that person look like to you? For many, that person would be rich, well-dressed, wearing a nice watch and cool sneakers, hopping on a private jet for a private island vacation, go to any event, and who's ever courtside or backstage, they must be successful. The people are fly, and you'll likely walk by a group of people who are in first class and think they must be successful. Perhaps you follow some people on social media with a significant amount of followers, and for you, that looks like success. Amen.
A study of lottery winners found that winning the lottery, the literal metaphor we use for the best thing that can happen to us, didn't make them happier. Instead, the winners adapted to their new circumstances, and the bar was raised. That dissatisfaction chases all of us, especially if we haven't been analytically about where our goals came from. Our definition of success can come from our family, friends, or our environment. But sometimes we don't pause long enough to ask God what his determination of success. We see what really mattered to Jesus and what he thought was successful in the Gospels.
When Jesus encountered a rich ruler, this was a guy who had everything most people would want: usefulness, wealth, and authority. Except Jesus wasn't impressed. The young man goes on to tell Jesus he's done well with the Ten Commandments. And at this point, I think we'd all say this guy is checking every box of what it means to be a successful Christian. And then Jesus tells him to go and sell all his possessions and give to the poor, and then that he would have treasures in heaven. Not one is righteous.
Treasures in heaven? Let's be honest. Most of us are looking for treasures on earth. The biggest difference between our definition of success and God's is ours is temporary and God is eternal. Our definition of success is primarily centered around getting, and God's definition of success is centered around giving.
I think Jesus is brilliant when he said in Acts 20:35, it is better to give than to receive. What do you think is better, making six figures a year or giving six figures away, people of God? This isn't about money as much as it is about mindset toward how we want to live on the earth. Amen. People of God, in Matthew 25, Jesus gives us a parable about three servants who were entrusted with different amounts of resources, each according to his ability. The success of each of those servants was measured by what they did with what they were given. We all have been given a different amount of resources to maximize our potential destiny. What has God given you? And how can you leverage that gift to make a difference in the world around you and to glorify God? Amen.
As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "You know the commandments." "Teacher," he declared, "all these I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack," he said, "go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard is it for the rich to enter the kingdom of God?" The disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God."
The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, "Who then can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "With man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." With God. Mark 10:17.
Again, it would be like a king, man going on a journey, who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave five bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here's what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers, so that when I return, I would have received it back in interest. For whosoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have, will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Matthew chapter 25, verses 14, 15, 25, 26a, 27b, 29 through 30.
Amen. People of God, this ends our Bible discussion for today on humility. What is it like to be on the other side of you? Are you a humble person? Humble yourself in the sight of God and He will lift you up. But if you exalt yourself, He will humble you. Amen? He does not like pride. We thank you for, you know, coming and getting on the Bible discussions and the scriptures that we give you. We hope that you go back and look over them and have your own Bible discussions with friends, neighbors, co-workers, family, whatever. And just go through the Word, because everything you need, every answer to everything in the world is in the Word of God. All you have to do is ask Him for the answer, but then you have to go and read it, people. You got to go like the seeker in search of the Word. And you have to find out for yourself through the Word what God is saying to you. You can't take others' word for it. It's no time for that. It is the last days, and it is dark, evil days, and a spirit of delusion is going to be released on the earth, okay? That it might deceive even the elect. So some of us say, hey, it would never deceive me because I know this and I know this. We don't know what could happen to our minds. We don't know just what state that we would be operating in, you know? But we know that if we have God, everything is possible, that He has promised to make provision for. He's coming to, the Holy Spirit has promised to deliver us home safely. Amen? So if you've listened to this study, and if God was speaking to your heart and saying things that you know you need to do by humbling yourself and thinking about what it is to be on the other side of you, boss lady, boss man, you know what I'm saying? What is it like to be on the other side of you, pastor, minister, man? You know, what is it like? How do you act? Are you arrogant? You know, do you lift yourself up and tell about your accomplishments and who you are, how much you make it into it? Amen. But we have to humble ourselves in the sight of God. And He is who lifts us up. That's where we get the honor and glory from the world, because God will give it to us if we serve Him and we humble ourselves. Amen. So, people of God, if you don't know Jesus, repeat this prayer or something like it. Amen. Father God, I've been living my life my own way, and now I want to live it your way. I believe that Jesus is your Son and that He died for my sins and rose again for my justification. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus, and help me to be the person that you created and died for me to be. Forgive me of my sins. And help me to be everything that you want me to be. I renounce sin, Satan, and all of his works. And Lord, I pray that you would hide behind Calvary, place the banner of your Son's blood over us. Lord, we pray that you would defend and protect. And we speak life in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, if you prayed that prayer, then you are saved. But your next assignment is to go and tell somebody. Take the assignment forward now. Go tell somebody that I heard a word today, you know, from this old lady, and she was talking about God. You know what I mean? And then tell them that you ask God to come in your life, and that you want to try to start living right. And then give him the keys, people of God. That's all he needs, is if you hand him the keys to the house, he's able to get in there and clean it up like only he can do it. Then he can stay there. If you don't let him clean it up, he cannot stay there. He will not stay there. You know, if you won't choose him in the world, he won't choose you when you see him face to face. He'll say, I never knew you. So get it together, people, at any cost. Humility is the word. Enjoy the rest of your week. We love you. God bless you is our prayer. We know this was a long one, but it was a good one. In Jesus' name, amen. The benediction.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Numbers chapter 6. Verses 24 through 26.
My people of God, shalom.
I haven't seen those eyes for quite some time. It's been a while. And there's something different in mine too. They've seen so many places, different faces, complications.